soldiers in a revolution. We're like soldiers of a revolution. There's a war going on in here. Gotta find us a better solution. Just let it all hang out. Or say something real. Say something real. Hey, girl. Say something real. Won't you say something real, girl? Say something real. Do, 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 baby. Say something real. Say something real. Say something real.
Good morning. What's happening, family? Welcome to the show this morning. It is Michelle Bryant here at WNOV 860 AM 106.5 FM. You're listening to Say Something Real. Good morning, Kay. What's up, bro?
Who that trying to get up with my crew?
Seriously. It just gave me good morning.
Why?
Like, y'all, do y'all have that person when y'all going to work? Y'all be like, here we go with this.
He be like, why the hell you keep talking to me?
I mean, like, everybody that's on your way to work, or you remember when you used to go to work and you see everybody getting out the cars. Hey, good morning. Hey, girl. Hey, bro. How you doing this morning? Da, da, da. And you see that one dude, you be like, here we go. Go. Mm-hmm. Keon, you the here we go dude.
Yeah, he work in the back by himself. You Negroes always over there messing with him. He like, why don't you take your ass to your station? Leave me alone. Early in the morning. From late in the evening. You gonna notice these people. They're savants. They're like magical Negroes.
What'd you make of my nose? You know what I'm saying?
They do their thing. Oh my God. Somebody always in their face want them to do it their way.
You get on my nerves.
Their way. You
get on my nerves.
Go ask Ken. Oh man.
Oh my God.
He's the fixer. She's the fixer. You know, they just always, you know.
I can't with you. Okay. Hey, Carvey. Good morning, bro. How you doing this morning? Don't be excited, too, because I say young Carvey. I know you think I'm letting it go. I'm not letting it go. I'm not. If I can run it up to May, I'm running it to May. All right, family, a lot to get to this morning. But, you know, I just got to take a second. We are in the process of early voting. And, you know, we got the main locations open. I'll run through that again. I have voted already this week or this period. I voted already. But there was some continued conversation about these referendums. And so particularly, you know, a conversation that came up yesterday regarding NPS. Folks have been listening to shows, you know, on both our dial and, you know, up and down the dial as people are out talking about the referendum. And there are a couple of things I think that we need to be clear on, because there are people that are out pushing information in relationship to the actual increase and hit to property taxes. And, you know, NPS, even on their handout that they have used, and I'm looking directly at it, it says, how would the referendum impact me? And then on the section where it says impact on taxes, NPS's plan would secure as many resources as possible for students while being mindful of taxpayers. A $100,000 home would see an estimated tax impact of $216 in the first year to unlock $252 million for students over 4 years. So there have been people that have been telling folks that the tax would only impact your property taxes for 1 year. That is not true. Stop that.
Shame on you.
That is not true. You are not impacted for 1 year. So first I had people telling folks that you had to be in a house that was like $250,000 or more for it to impact you. No. A house that's a $100,000 home. And that's just the example. I don't know that this increase starts with houses that are valued at $100,000 or more. If you own a home, you're not going to be exempt from this property tax. So we need to get people that's just being a whole lot more forthcoming with the community. And again, I'm not trying to tell you how to vote one way or the other, but I do need you to have the best information. This is not a one and done tax hit. It's not. One of the things that they even say on their flyer, after year one, the tax rate in relationship to the referendum would stay steady.
After year one.
So what does stay steady mean? Does that mean it would go away? You only pay this one time and it's over? Because if that's the intent, then that's what the language ought to say, as opposed to in relationship to the referendum, it would stay steady. What does stay steady mean?
Kind of level.
Does stay steady mean that, you know, it goes back, it's a one and done? Because if it's one and done, people ought to say that.
That's not steady.
That's not stay steady.
Steady on a case. Regulated. It's going to be here for a minute.
So when folks say it's only going to cost me $216, you know.
Every year.
No, some folks are saying you're going to pay $216 one time and then that's it. That's not how this reads.
No.
So I'm hearing from somebody. Somebody was saying, I'll send you the facts and we will be on Friday to talk about the data, facts without bias. But answer this question for me, since you're listening. Is the $216 a one and done hit to taxpayers? So after I go up and increase, and this is again, only if your home, the example provided was $100,000, you would pay that $216. But if the house is valued at more than $100,000, then that amount is higher than 216 because this is a percentage. It is calculated on the value of your home. And if you are under $100,000, are you impacted as well? Let me see. Somebody else says, good morning. Thanks for the information. We get taxed to death in Milwaukee. Wheel tax, Milwaukee Brewers tax, NPS tax, 2%. Lord, help us. I mean, we just got to be as clear as we can with people. So when folks walking into the room, you know, they understand, is this really a $216 tax? Is this something for a $100,000 home? Because if the house is worth more than $100,000, the tax is more than $216. And is this one and done, or is this over the course of 3-4 years and I'm really going to pay about $800, $1,000? What are we actually telling people? And I'm looking at the sheet from the referendum, about the referendum on the NPS website. And again, that's their language. Their language says impact on taxes. A $100,000 home would see an estimated tax impact of $216 in the first year. It does not say for people that have been telling folks that you got to have a house worth so much money to be impacted. That's not true, because we don't get to, in the state of Wisconsin, only hit certain tax home, certain homeowners. Everybody has to be hit. And how do I know that? Because when we were trying to introduce legislation similar to what's done in a lot of southern states that freezes property taxes for seniors. So people 65 or 70, that freezes the property taxes for them. And, you know, the state told us that, like, no, you cannot. Somebody said my home is a $200,000 home. So, yeah, I'm at $432 in property taxes. But, yeah, the state told us you'd have to change the Constitution to be able to do special preference type tax policies for, you know, members of the community. So if you wanted to protect seniors so that they don't get priced out of their homes when they retire and property values continue to go up and they eventually get priced out because they can no longer afford the property values. The property taxes because their income is now fixed. Southern states, many of them have figured out ways to address that. In Wisconsin, it requires a constitutional change. So this tax rate increase applies to everyone. Okay, so let me see. Somebody just sent me a link they wanted me to look at. This equals $2.11 per $100,000 of assessed value, or $425 a year for the average MKE homeowner. So they're saying the average MKE homeowner is going to see $425. That's in an actual document, you know, from City Forward Collective that talks about this, because the average homeowner in Milwaukee's home is valued at more than $100,000. And so as MPS has chosen to talk about this, of course, it seems like they took the lowest denominator, the $100,000, to sell people. So you sitting here going, well, $216 is not the end of the world, but the average homeowner's home is worth more than $100,000. So you are particularly, so you are potentially talking about what City Forward says is about $425 a year for the average homeowner. That sounds different to people than 216. If City Forward Collective's information is correct, and that the average homeowner in Milwaukee would pay $425 a year increase in property taxes, that sounds very different than $216 a year. See, that's that piece. When you're talking to people, you got to be able to have folks that's going to force them to drill down on what they're telling people. And you got a number of state elected officials, you know, that are out championing the referendum. And some of these people, to me, don't clearly understand what it is they're asking taxpayers to do. Now, there are taxpayers that will be like, you know what, I'm still fine with it, Michelle, because I value, you know, what we are trying to do here, which is to get more resources into the hands of our students. So then the other part of that question has to be, tell me how that shows up on students, because when they talk about we're going to advance education classes, mental health supports, that they said these programs are at risk of being cut. So does that mean you're just going to be able to prop up existing programming, or am I getting new programming? I just am concerned about how information is being given to people. So it says, this is again on the MPS website on their flyer. How has MPS expanded programming? They talk about since 2020, what they've done. And then, you know, students benefit from, and then they list these whole things. But again, this refers to 2020. So are you saying that this money is going to be just so they can prop up existing programming? I know I had heard on some programs, they were talking about, you know, increases in music programs, arts programs. I thought I heard somewhere about teachers' raises or salaries. I'm just saying, I would love for somebody to just actually just lay it straight on the table. I would love for somebody to say, no matter what the value of your home is, the additional property tax you're going to pay will be 1.3%. So I can calculate that myself. How much is the additional, you know, what's that number? We're asking them to put a 1.3% tax on all property, you know, owners. Because if we just do the math real quick on 100,000, let me see if I can do it real quick and see if I can come up with the percentage on my own. So let me see if I remember how to do this. You divide it. 2.11.
You know, after the new man.
Divide it. Hey, I got to do what I know. So if my math is correct and you divide, if they said it's on average $2.11, and if you divide that by 100,000, that gets you less than 1% in a tax. It's like 0.00021. All right, so not even a half a percent in terms of the rate. But you want somebody to be able to break that down for you so you can figure out how this impacts you. The other thing is to make sure that you are telling people this is not a one and done tax. You don't pay it 1 year and never pay it again. Again, if that's the case, spell that out better. But the very fact that it says a home will see an estimated tax impact of about $216, a $100,000 home in the first year, to unlock this money for students over 4 years, after year one, the tax rate in relationship to the referendum will stay steady. What does that mean? What does stay steady mean? Because here is a great way to better and more effectively communicate. People understand this is a one-time tax. They don't necessarily understand what stay steady means. It's one thing if I think I'm about to hand you $216, $435, $434, whatever the numbers are, you know, one time. I can live with that. But if you're telling me that's what I'm getting ready to do over the course of 4 years, it's a different conversation now. Got a caller on the line. Let me go to the phones. Hey, caller. Good morning. What's happening?
Good morning, Michelle. And I'm glad you really dove into this and trying to break it down and really get people to understand. Most homes in central cities are not $100,000. Granted, some of them should be, but they're not marketing them like that. We're really getting cut up when it comes to selling our homes because of the area we live in. But I'm going to tell you this much right now. Get some people that have sold their home in the last month that did get $100,000 for their house. And it should be clear. Don't tell me it's a one-time thing and then say the next years will be studied. Now you're double talking. Don't double talk me. Tell me what it's going to be right up front. And then tell me if my home is, you have it appraised from the city at $65,000. Okay, that's not $100,000, but everybody's going to be taxed. So it ought to be a percentage, like you're saying, so that people can understand and comprehend what's going on. When you do all this for dating around, that's what makes people distrust you. And you can't blend all this real tax, this tax. Everybody's hitting us left and right. And I feel that. But who's going to suffer at the end of the day? Just like you can tell us what you want for that money, tell us what you're going to do for our children that's different. And if I'm understanding something, that they find out from doing, I don't care what organization you're in, you ought to be audited and see if this money is going into this pocket and it is staying there. Is this money being allocated to this and it's going there? Is someone losing their job because, or did that have something to do with the city or where money was mismanaged?
Are you asking a question?
Yeah, because somebody said somebody's going to be leaving at the end of the school year because something, I don't know if money wasn't spent like it was supposed to. Am I getting this confused with some other city thing or I don't know?
Well, I know in Glendale, they had an issue with a school board and what was happening. And somebody, you know, was not, they weren't stealing, but they really didn't know what they was doing as like the accountant or the bookkeeper for the district. So that was Glendale. That was not Milwaukee.
Okay. You don't get a free pass because you don't know what you're doing. And I have another question. When you be a comptroller, are you supposed to have some required credentials? Or do they just let anybody, like some people that are judges down there just have a high school education somewhere? And some are required to be licensed, accredited lawyers. So where are we with a comptroller? How do you come in and get this job?
So in order to be like you said, the states and state statute can, because these are elected positions, they can make some of those determinations. So in the city of Milwaukee, you have to have a law degree to be a judge in the city of Milwaukee. But okay, that may not be the case all over the entire state. I need to go back and look. And I know that other states do it differently, as you pointed out. Some states, you don't have to have a law degree to be a judge. I remember, you know, famous cases out of New York where smaller communities, the guy was a plumber and he was a judge too. And it was just like the decisions he was making was so crazy, but he got elected to the position. So let me look up the comptroller position for the city of Milwaukee and see if there are any actual requirements on that. And I'll let you know after I come back from the break.
Okay, thank you so much.
All right, bye-bye. Thank you so much. Somebody just mentioned Judge Steve Harvey. Jesus Christ. Woo! All right, family, I'll be right back. Michelle Bryant, WNOV, 860 AM, 106.5 FM. Real talk this morning.
WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee. WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
March is a great time to honor women who have paved the way for their community, and Martha Love has done just that. As a founder, community activist, political organizer, and labor leader in Milwaukee County for over 37 years, Martha has shown her love for Milwaukee and passion for seeing the community thrive. Be sure to celebrate her story during Women's History Month.
This moment in women's history was brought to you by U.S. Bank. U.S. Bank has more than 50 locations in the greater Milwaukee area. Visit usbank.com to find a location near you. U.S. Bank, a member of FDIC.
For an Allstate agent, providing protection options that fit your life is something that they take well. Personally, Allstate agents are committed to learning about your needs and helping customize protection to meet them. From bundling your home and auto insurance with ease, to evaluating optional coverage, your Allstate agent can help build an insurance proposal that fits your life. And just as important as learning what you need is learning what you don't. Because helping you get the coverage you want with the savings you deserve is what Allstate is all about. It's time to get coverage that's catered to you. Are you in good hands? Call Milwaukee Allstate agent Cindy Johnson at 414-445-2558. That's 414-445-2558. Today, for a free quote, home, auto, renters, condo, and more. Sydney, Nancy, and Lyndon can't wait to meet you.
Subject to terms and conditions and availability. Allstate Fire and Casualty Insurance Company and Allstate Property and Casualty Insurance Company and its affiliates, Northbrook, Illinois.
Easter and prom is here, and graduation is near. Stop by Nicovani's, where they have a large variety of suits, blazers, and shoes to get you right for that special day. You already know Nicovani has the $100 hookup. You can get a suit, shirt, tie, and shoes, all for just $100. They're open 7 days a week with an on-site tailor. Nicovani's on the second floor of the Mayfair Mall across from the movie theater. It's the place to shop for men.
Increase in taxes while families are paying more for everything from gas to groceries is wrong. Milwaukee voters should oppose increase in property taxes by nearly 30% in order to provide increased funding yet again to Milwaukee Public Schools. They've already wasted nearly $1 billion in new taxpayer funding, and now they want more? They don't even have a plan on how they'll spend it. Enough is enough. Milwaukee voters should just say no.
Paid for by Enough is Enough. Vote no.
Hey, this is School Board Director Daryl Jackson, who represents District 3 for NPS.
NPS School Board Director Aisha Carr represents District 4.
Tune in this Friday from 7 to 9 a.m. as we discuss
all things NPS referendum and as we talk about the state of emergency in education in the city of Milwaukee.
You're listening to WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
This is how we do it.
This is how we do it.
La, 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 la.
Now, back to Say Something Real with your host, Michelle Bryant, on 860 WNOV.
Money over here, yeah. Feel so good in my hood tonight. All the dang dang, just forgot about the forgot about the drive by.
Gotta get your groove on
before you go get paid. So tip up your cup and throw your hands up and let me hit the party.
The mic's not on me. I cannot scare you. Oh my God.
Why else would
I was looking for real.
Why else would I be
you
singing
are
back up with
so
you?
So raggedy. Oh my God.
I heard you mess up every lyric.
But I actually know that. I actually know that.
If they're not in order.
Yo, come on.
Yeah.
All right. Welcome back to the show, folks. So before we went to break, taking just a second to talk about this NPS school referendum, because I've just been hearing a number of things that do not line up, and I need our community to know as much as they can before they cast a ballot one way or the other for this. I hear it. The police? What? You don't forget where they go? Is it a chase? Well, there's number one.
Didn't it sound like 15 of them?
It sounded deep, but right now I've only seen one.
They got too many speakers.
Maybe
on
they're
car.
Coming in from this,
no,
from somewhere
they got
else.
Too many speakers.
You know,
on
you live
car.
On. I mean, you work and live on Capitol Drive. You get all the flavor and the drama. But so talking NPS referendum again. I'm trying to make sure that taxpayers, voters are clear when they go to the polls exactly what it is they're voting for. If this is a one and done tax, if this is a hike to your property taxes, if it levels off. I've read something again connected to the NPS website where it talks about it stays steady or in some cases it could decrease. So that was one thing. And then the caller called in and they talked about qualifications to be comptroller. When you run for elected office in Milwaukee or even in the state, in most cases, the qualifications to run for candidacy are very, very minimal. You got to be a state resident. You cannot be a felon that has not been pardoned or expunged or, you know, whatever the process is. I don't see education requirements for an elected comptroller's position. So I can't find them anywhere. I'm on the City of Milwaukee Election Commission website. I don't see anything that says you have to meet X, Y, and Z requirements to be elected to the position of comptroller. It's just like at the state, you know, you just probably need to be 18 and not have a felony record that has not been addressed in some way in terms of expungement or pardon or something like that, I guess, with the courts. But yeah, like you got people making decisions who, yeah.
You got one on there, you can ask.
Oh, no, I'm getting ready to. I see him. But I'm just saying, you know, because we talk about the comptroller. Don't nobody ask that question about the state. Don't nobody ask that question about the county executive's office, the mayor's office. There are no educational requirements to be the mayor of the City of Milwaukee. None.
Here we go.
None.
Once upon a time.
No educational requirements to be the county executive. I mean, these are elected positions. The people get to decide. And a lot of times the people don't do their due diligence about who they turning the keys over to. Let me go to the phone line. Hey, caller, what's happening?
Good morning, Michelle.
What's up, bro? How you doing this morning?
Good morning. Michael Harper, candidate for Milwaukee County Comptroller.
Yes, sir.
So Wisconsin Statute 59.255 sets the requirements for the educational requirements, and Milwaukee County Government Ordinance Chapter 34 also establishes that. So minimally, you have to have a master's degree or be a CPA to be eligible to run for this particular position. So you do have some educational requirements that are necessary. I possess those. That's why I put my hat in the ring. And I look forward to the support of the community.
Well, first of all, thank you so much for that information and clarification, because, like I said, ironically, not really clear and evident on the Milwaukee Home election page. So I think people need to do a better job of, you know, making that known, so I don't have to be able to dig through state statutes 59.2 and figure out what the educational requirements are. And people that are lay folks that are just trying to understand in general what's happening can feel a degree of comfort in understanding what the qualifications are to be able to run for these offices. I figured something needed to be in place, because if you look at all the other, but you know, but then I couldn't take it for granted, because if you look at all the other positions within that comptroller's office, there are educational requirements for the majority of those positions, because I see job postings and see what they're asking for. But I think about it again, like in the state, we can have state elected officials who have no formal education, but their staff will be more educated than the elected official in some cases. And, you know, and then, you know, like even your pay is determinant as a state employee on education and work experience. And we have elected officials that couldn't even be actually supervisors because they don't meet the educational requirements to even do that. So it's a dicey thing when you start talking about elected positions. So I just appreciate you taking a minute to educate the community on that. Since I got you on the phone, let me just ask a question. How's the campaign going? I'm seeing your yard signs out.
Well, we're going to keep working hard. We're going to run through the tape, and we're going to keep our head down and earn the votes and become the next county comptroller.
Well, you know, good luck to you, bro. Like I said, I have been, somebody said Scott Walker couldn't even get Marquette to give him an honorary degree. I'm so silly. Well, good luck to you. We'll get you back in the studio before election day and on election day. Yes, sir. Appreciate you. Thank you.
All right
now. And you know, I had Bill Christensen in yesterday, and he went through his credentials, his background, you know, and he definitely meets the requirements for that particular position. Greg Grotz. Did you have a piece of lit from Greg? Keon, you still got that?
Yeah.
Because I don't know what his background is in terms of the master's degree and CPA degree information that was outlined by Mike. It's not on here. He just has what he wants to do. So as the Grotz for comptroller, his card says,
is he city comptroller or is county comptroller?
He's going for city comptroller. Oh, yeah. That's the one.
That might be different from state to city, though.
From state to county?
State to county, yeah. County to city. Because I know he's a union guy. He was just on Be a Voice.
Yeah.
Recently,
but I still... Yeah, I can look and see. But, you know, it's funny because as he talks about, he wants to be the city of Milwaukee comptroller. I pledge to ensure that dedicated sales tax dollars are used to hire additional police and firefighters. Why is that on here? Why is the city comptroller worried about we need to hire more police and fire? See, people be on that nonsense. An independent check on Milwaukee's budget. Like, how the hell you got more police and fire above the independent check on Milwaukee's budget? See, people get their roles mixed up. And that's the part that irritates me, because now you're speaking to the base. You know, you speaking to who you think you need to help pull you across the finish line. I'm trying to figure out why a person running for comptroller believes it's their priority to make sure we got more police and firefighters. That's not your priority as the comptroller. That's not your priority. Okay, so see, I got sidetracked. All right. Yeah, it is dog whistle. Somebody said, you know, what particular voter demographic is he going after? I mean, come on, people know. Like, I see you, bro. I see you. All right. So with that being said, and speaking of the base and people going after the base, let me take a quick second. What do I want to do? Let me do this quickly, because I can run this real fast. I had mentioned that we were in the sentencing phase for the officers involved in beating the two Black men. I just want to pull it up. Sentenced. Okay. So the off. What? Go ahead.
I was going to say, well, while you were pulling that up, we needed to handle something real quick.
Okay, go ahead.
The Trump economy was a disaster for Black America. He prioritized the wealthy and big business, not us, giving them tax breaks while we got left behind. Under Trump, hundreds of thousands of Black Americans lost health insurance in the middle of a pandemic. And don't forget the division, the violence, and disrespect we faced while he was in charge. Now, he's coming after our voting rights. And if he's president again, Trump vowed to be a, quote, dictator who would get revenge. We can't go back. President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris are working hard for Black America. They sent $1,400 cash relief checks when they were needed most. Our wages are up. We've got millions of new good-paying jobs. And the cost of insulin is capped at $35 for seniors. There's more to do, but it's clear that on the economy, Black America is getting ahead with President Joe Biden and Vice President Kamala Harris.
I'm Joe Biden, candidate for president, and I approve this message.
Paid for by Biden for President.
All right, family. Thank you for giving me a second. I appreciate the commercial break. So the story that I wanted to quickly just hit on just as an update, because I really, you know, have been insistent on following what's happening to these officers. So remember down in Rankin County, Mississippi, where I talked about the two brothers were in their home and police officers, about six of them, show up. And no warrant, bust up in the house and start harassing the brothers, beating them, at one point stripped them, put them in the shower together, naked, tried to make them have some type of sexual act with one another. The brothers wouldn't do it. At some point, an officer puts a gun in the mouth of one of the young men, and the gun discharges, and this man's tongue is lacerated, so his tongue is cut. I don't know if it was completely cut off, but tongue is cut. You tear up the inside of this man's mouth. And all of this was done because somebody called 911 and said there are two Black men staying at a house with a white woman. That's how this started. Because I've never fully just talked about how it started. A 911 call came in, and some special person wanted to flag for the police department that there were two Black men. They didn't say these Black men looked like they were holding the woman hostage. It was a dangerous situation. You know, they were robbing her. They said two Black men are staying with a white woman at 3240 Oak Avenue, fictitious address. Actually, that's my grandfather's address. But that's what's happening.
Great state of Mississippi.
And so, you know, these white officers, who somebody who hears the call, well, they feel the need to go over and check it in, because how dare two Black men be staying at the house with a white woman? Not assaulting. And it, from all accounts, the white woman was not there when they got there, you know, but this self-described goon squad, you know, because you do know you're a Mississippi boy. We don't let the races mingle in Mississippi, boy. Mm-hmm. How dare you think you should be at the house of a good white woman, boy? Mm-hmm. And they go in and they humiliate these brothers. They physically assault, sexually assault these men. So the sentences have begun to roll in. I talked about in that most of them were looking at up to 40 years in prison. So by, at this point, we've had four of them that have now been sentenced. We got two more. Those should be happening today. The fourth officer to plead guilty, he was sentenced to 40 years in prison yesterday. And the other guy, I think he got 14 years. I'm trying to figure out, because I was looking to see why his sentence was significantly lower. But he ended up getting 14 years. So we've gotten officers that... the third, he got 17 years, 17-year prison term. And two other officers have received 20 years. That first one, that came down on Tuesday. That was one of the sheriffs. His last name was Elward, and another one named Middleton. So Elward got 20 years, and he was the one who actually shot the man in the mouth. I don't know how you only get 20 years when you're the only one that actually fired a gun and you know, hit somebody in the mouth. But he got 20. Middleton got 17 and a half years in prison. And then there are other charges that they're facing.
Did you say hit somebody in the mouth? He shot him from the mouth.
I mean, my bad. You know, I don't mean that. I don't mean that. So I just want to update that those sentencings are happening, and that, you know, there will be people that turn around and be like, well, is this really enough? They are facing additional charges. So let's just be clear. There is more to come. They're not done. And one officer yesterday, you know, he talked about, you know, this was like the worst thing I've ever done. You know, basically, I'm ashamed. I can't believe I did this. You know, he kind of had some remorse. But I'm sure everybody's remorseful when you talk about 17 and a half years in prison, 20 years in prison. But we'll, you know, we'll see. So the last two, like I said, those should fall through today. Before I go to this thing on Trump, somebody hit me up and said, you mentioned and laughed about Judge Steve Harvey, who is not a real judge or a lawyer. But did you know that Judge Judy makes $47 million annual salary? But let me look and see, too. Because she's a real judge, though, is,
and people like her, judge, like that. They tune in for her to make $47 million.
So, and it talks about Judy is a retired judge, so she's a real judge. You know, she's not playing a judge on TV. She's a real judge, number one. But they said on the show, even though it's called Judge Judy, her role is actually that of an arbitrator. Meaning she can only decide the cases because the parties have agreed to be bound by her decision. So in a real situation with a judicial court, the parties don't get to say, you know, we only participate if the judge, you know, that we agree to be bound by the judge's decision. The judge don't care if you agree to be bound by the decision. What decision the judge gives, that's what it is. So she's actually considered an arbitrator, not an actual judge on the show. That probably is the case for most of the other judges that have television shows, that people have to agree, you know, that they're going to abide by the findings. But the other piece is that Judith Sheindlin is somebody that has a long and storied career, and she makes millions of dollars for the networks. So it's just like, you know, being in the NFL or anywhere else, NBA, if I'm making you this kind of money, I should be paid accordingly. So I'm not salty, you know, and I'm not saying that the person who sent me the text is salty about her making $47 million. But first, let's be clear. What these other folks are, she's actually a real judge, a retired judge. Did you want to say something?
Yeah, baby, you think I got a little journal book and I had wrote in there, it should be illegal for people over the age of 70 to watch Judge Judy. I said, Granny, she can't hear you, fam. At the TV yelling. That's why she made 47. People be going, hell. What the hell? They can't hear you, Grandma? Yeah, phone call.
Okay. And, you know, and there's people like, well, whether she's a licensed, you know, she's not a judge anymore. She still was a judge, y'all. She was a judge out of New York, family court law. You know, but she was a judge. Like, people, leave this woman alone. Leave these people alone, you know, because at least you know there's a legal background. Somebody went to law school versus Steve Harvey with his water head. Said, that's it at all.
Yeah.
Steve Harvey sitting up making decisions like, boy, go, stop. I mean, I ain't mad at your hustle, but the message that it sends to our kids and the culture and the community is scandalous. Like, because I think Jerry Springer is actually a lawyer.
Yeah.
I got to go back and look. Let me go to the phone line.
He was an elected official, too.
Yeah, he was an elected official. I remember that. Let me see. Is Jerry Springer a
Apparently
lawyer?
He's a drama major, or at least his producers are.
Jerry Springer is a lawyer. What? His name is Gerald Norman Springer. Oh, my God. Oh, he passed away. I forgot that.
Yeah.
So he was broadcaster, journalist, actor, producer, lawyer, and politician. Yep. So Jerry Springer was actually at least an attorney. Steve Harvey just up here just chilling. Somebody says Steve Harvey got his wife in his back pocket, so he has to work. She in his back pocket. She in his front pocket. She tapping all of it. But I ain't mad at her because she done helped elevate Steve because, you know, the way he was dressing before he got with Marjorie. So she done increased his game. She done helped him out. Let me go to the phone line. Hey, caller, what's happening?
Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
You know, I just heard a commercial on WNOV. it was endorsed by Joe Biden. Now, any black person that can think for themselves or any white person, this was a target towards black folks, that the economy is going much greater, and they gave us $1,400, which I ain't never done mine. I didn't ask for it. Look at $1,400 do for anybody today when your average rent is $1,000 to $1,200. That's a joke going to pandemic. They claim in this commercial. Do you understand that from 2016 to 2020, the black unemployment rate was like 3%? How can they come on there and say, and then black people that is unlearned, that won't do the studies, such as yourself, you study, they just take this kind of garbage that's fed to us, and we supposed to pull over and start feasting upon it. This is not true stuff. And we can say, well, Obama left a surplus and had it going. That's correct. We got to give dudes some play. Just like we had to give Bill Clinton some play when he got a deficit going. But you have to look where that money came from. During the Bill Clinton years, they got a deficit because what they did. They allowed the free prison enterprise to come about. Then they took to make sure that industry thrived, they took SSI from drug and alcoholics that were deemed an incurable disease.
Hey, Wink.
The Reagan that put in place, it was an incurable disease.
Wink.
And they took that back, and then these addicts were left with no money to make sure that the prison system thrived.
Hey, Winky.
People don't understand and don't follow that.
Winky.
Now, that
Winky.
Was a lot.
Winky.
Yeah.
Hold on 1 minute.
Now, President Biden might be 81 years old, but tonight he proved that he's 46. When President Biden said at the State of the Union that he was turning a setback to a comeback, oh, he meant that shit. 15 million new jobs, 800 manufacturing jobs, record low unemployment, inflation from 9% to 3%, infrastructure law, American Rescue Plan, CHIPS and Science Act, capping the cost for insulin for seniors to $35. Now, he didn't say the number, but I'm going to tell you that number. $1.5 billion alone in 2023 to black-owned businesses, solely to black-owned businesses. Let's talk about tangibles, Chief. Now, I love the fact that he called out Republicans on their shit. Now, he said, it's funny that you guys voted against the infrastructure bill, but y'all cheering on the money being sent to your district. And even without saying that nigga for the MAGA position name, he said, you cannot claim to love your country only when you win. Shit, that was a bar. Okay, Cardi B, Nicki Minaj, y'all ain't got fresh on Biden. Now, Biden, drop the mic and drop the mixtape, okay? Because we buying it, Jip, okay? FOMO.
Hey, listen. That particular commercial right there is full of maggots, full of untruth, and he got a zesty boy, a flaming sissy, making these
things. Hold on a second. Turn them down. You know, see, I'm willing to obviously have you express your position. But, you know, what I tell you consistently, you cannot do. Whatever your hangups are with people's sexual orientation, man, leave that at your house. Leave that in your circle. You don't get to call the radio station and want to pass your beliefs about sexual orientation on to the listeners in terms of calling people a flaming sissy, you know, a faggot, whatever words, terminology you feel like using that day. You don't get to disrespect people, bruh, because people don't. Well, a lot of people do want to disrespect you, and I understand why, but you don't get to do that, fam. And so when you can like mature and have conversations, you know, that don't have to like try to like degrade somebody, because whether you gay or not does not impact your ability to intellectually understand the economy. It has nothing to do with it. Some of the greatest leaders in the African-American community that have done monumental work have been people that were gay. So you don't get to keep doing that. And I just, did you hang up on him? Please hang up on him, because I want to hear it. I want to hear it today. So when you learn how to call here and talk without degrading people based on sexual orientation, we're free to have the conversations. Because what you consistently continue to do is show how limited you are in your abilities, because you have to sink to the lowest denominator all the time. It's tons of people that don't agree with gay lifestyles, and they call here and make opinions known without, you know, coming after those people. Leave them people alone, man. That man is he is a taxpayer. He probably is a homeowner. He contributes. He goes to work every day. So is his opinion any less because he's gay? Your words a sissy? You don't get to have an opinion? You don't get to have an opinion. But the heterosexuals, who in some cases whooping on their wives, cheating on their wives, you know, stealing from their companies, we can hear what you got to say because you don't swing a certain way sexually. The ignorance. The utter ignorance. It's a whole bunch of straight people that have run this country straight into the ground. Let's start with your boy that you always calling in here to protect and to hold up, Donald Trump. Far as I know, he ain't gay, but he worse than anybody ever in terms of leading this country. He don't know, even though, you know, you talk about sex, he don't even know how to control himself to the point that 19 women accuse him of sexual assault. And then he can brag to somebody about grabbing women by their private parts. So that's who we uplift. And that's whose position we care about. The sexual molester and the perv who said he could date his daughter. That's who we uplift. But because somebody else, you hear a little something in their voice, their sexual orientation is in question, they might be gay. We don't want to hear what he got to say. But let me hear what the nasty, filthy, pervert dog got to say. Let me do that. I just want to be clear for all you black Republicans that be calling here with y'all nonsense, trying to support this dude and to some way justify this ignorant man being the president of the United States. What is wrong with you Negroes? You're going to get behind Filthy, who talks about looking at his daughter in a sexual way. You're going to get behind that dude. That's who we getting behind, who cheats on his wife while she's pregnant with some chick that's a stanky in the Playboy Club. That's who you're going to get behind. The other brother who called to hear talking about his damn morals. Your morals must be flimsy as a wet piece of paper. And then damn near forced to tears trying to make excuses for this raggedy. But because somebody gay, James Baldwin, Bayard Rustin, Nikki Giovanni, you know, let me just name the amazing people in our community that happen to also be gay. Because you gay, what you say does not matter. What you say is called into question. But the pervert who is eyeing his daughter, and when she was sitting on his lap, probably got a hard on, that's who we want to, that's who we want to get behind. That's who we want to support. That's who we want to listen to. Yeah, my patience for y'all and this nonsense is just wearing real thin. And as you hopefully understand, you was free to make your point, but you're not going to make your point and try to dog and clown people on the way because they love differently than you do. That we're not going to do. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of it. Let me take a break. I'll be right back.
Located at 2031 West on Capitol Drive. Stick your tickets up 45 minutes past 50 at the door. On my way meet me there. Brunch at 1, the show begins at 4 p.m. The fabulous Lucky Brothers, my soul is a witness. I feel it down on the inside. Be right there at Abundant Faith, located at 7830 West Good Hope Road. All Willie Rogers. We're going to a meeting on that day. I see them marching down the street. Come on in from everywhere, north, west, south. Oh, it's going down. There's a leak in this old building, Bishop Neil Robinson, and my soul has got to move. Don't you miss it. Call the New Pits Mortuary 414-447-6000. It's going down at the Soul Stirring Gospel Easter Bash. Oh, I gotta stop right there, Brian McIntosh. My feet got light. I feel myself flying right about now. Come on now. You don't want to miss it. Be right there in the house. It's going down. Come on now. Chippin' and tearing. Everybody know he's my friend. Oh, you don't want to miss it. You be right there. That Soul Stirring Gospel Easter Bash. That food is going to be yummy, yummy, yummy. I'll tell you, come on now, Reverend R.L. Bush and the Revived Son. Put the weight on me. Oh, not that kind of weight, because that food going to be so sculpted. Pick your tickets up at the New Pits Mortuary.
Tickets are also available at Nicovani's and Mayfair Mall on the second floor.
The next election is Tuesday, April 2nd. And as we know, elections have consequences. Not being informed about election dates, candidates, and the issues have consequences. And the price we pay can be costly. On Saturday, March 23rd, the Executive Committee of the Community Brainstorming Conference invites you to their Spring Candidates Forum to hear from candidates on the ballot at various levels of government. Attend this informative program at St. Matthew CME Church, 2944 North 9th Street, again on March 23rd. Never a charge to attend. Continental breakfast served at 8 a.m. Program starts at 9 a.m. You can also join online by visiting communitybrainstormingconference.org.
Black history is something to appreciate, celebrate, and participate. Play Ode is a mobile app that streams America's best Black-owned radio stations and podcasts from across the country. ODE stands for Our Digital Entertainment. Play Ode features music and entertainment for us and by us. Listen to WNOV The Voice Milwaukee on the Play Ode app. Elevate your radio listening and participate in supporting Black radio. Download PLAYODE or log on to odeaudio.com for info and insight.
Make it a real Mad March with a playoff payout at Pottawatomie. Every week, you could score your share of 100 grand in cash and free play. Play this March for drawing entries. Win each Thursday. Plus, the prizes refresh every week for even more winners. The playoff payout at Pottawatomie, Milwaukee. It's anyone's game. For more details, visit paysbig.com/payout. Must be 21 and a club member to play.
Hey, Milwaukee, this is your favorite DJ, DJ L Boogie, and I just joined the family over here at WNOV, the all-new 106.5 FM, 860 AM, and I'm going to be rocking the Saturday Mix Show. So check me out every Saturday right here on the station, 9 p.m. to midnight, every Saturday. It's the Mix Show with
DJ L Boogie.
Turn me up.
You're listening to WNOV 860 and W293CX 106.5 Milwaukee.
Trust in you.
dough. Cause you need dough.